Papillon by Henri Charrier. The prison at Rio Hex. We left at dawn. The doctor and the nuns came to say goodbye. We slept our mornings easily. The wind took us right away and we sailed out of the harbor. A brilliant sun came up and we had an untroubled day before us. In no time, I found that the boat had too much in the way of sail and not enough ballast. I made up my mind to be very cautious. We raced along. From the point of view of speed, this boat was a thoroughbred, but she was very touchy and nervous. I steered due west. It had been decided that we should land our 3 passengers from Trinidad illegally on the coast of Colombia. They wouldn't have anything whatever to do with the long voyage. They said they trusted in me, all right, but not in the weather. And in fact, the forecast in the papers we had read in prison spoke of storms and red hurricanes. I acknowledged they were within their rights and it was agreed we should land them on a barren, inhabited peninsula called Guajira. As 4 of us, we should set off again for British Honduras. The weather was magnificent and the starlit night was a brilliant half moon, made our scheme for landing them all the easier. We ran straight for the Colombian coast. I dropped anchor and foot by foot we sounded to see when they could go ashore. Unhappily, the water was very deep and we had to go dangerously close to the rocky coast before we had less than 5 feet. We shook hands, each of them got out, stood there in the sea with this suitcase on his head and waded to the land. We watched them closely and rather sadly, they were companions who had faced up to the things well. They had never let us down at any time. It was a pity they were leaving the boat. While they were making their way ashore, the wind dropped in entirely. Hell, what if we were seen from the village shown on the map? The village called Rio Heca? That was the nearest port with police in it. Let's hope not. I had the feelings we were much nearer than we had meant to be because of that lighthouse on the headland we had just passed. Wait, wait. The three men had disappeared, having waved goodbye with a white handkerchief. A breeze, for God's sake. A breeze to carry us away from the Colombian coast. Far as we were concerned, the country was one big question mark. No one knew whenever they handed escaped prisoners back or not. All three of us would rather have the certainty of British Honduras than this unknown Colombia. It was not until 3 in the afternoon that there was a wind and we were able to get underway. I said everything, and with perhaps too much abroad, we sailed along for a couple of hours. Then a launch filled with men appeared, steering straight for us and firing shots in the air to make a stop. I ran on without obeying, trying to get out of sea, out of terrestrial waters. Impossible. The powerful launch caught up with us less than an hour and a half chase, and with 10 rifles pointing at us, we were forced to surrender. The soldiers, or maybe policemen who had arrested us all, had much the same look. They were all wore dirty trousers that had been once been white, and ragged singlets that had never been washed at any time. And then they were all of them, except for the captain, barefoot. He was better dressed and cleaner. But although they were badly dressed, they were very, very, very well armed. A full cartridge belt around their waist, well-kept rifles, and a long shattered dagger into the bargain. The hill just at hand. The one they called captain looked like a half-caste and a murderer. He had a heavy revolver and he too wore it with a well-filled bandolier. As they only spoke Spanish, we could not make out their meaning, but neither their hands looked nor their motions nor their tone of voice were friendly. Far from it. We walked from the harbor to the prison, going through the village, which was indeed Rio Heca. Escorted by 6 tough, with 3 more a couple of paces behind, their guns trained on us. It was not the most friendly of welcomes. We reached the courtyard of a prison with a little wall around it. There were around 20 dirty, bearded prisoners sitting about or standing, and they were looking at us with hostile eyes. Vamos, vamos. We understood the soldiers to mean, come on, come on. which was hard for us because although Cloutier was a good deal better, he had to walk on the iron in his plastered leg and he could not go fast. The captain had stayed behind and now he caught us up with the compass and the oilskin under his arm. He was eating our biscuit and chocolates and we instantly grasped that we are going to be stripped bare. And we were not mistaken either. They set us up in the filthy room with a heavy bars over the window. There were some planks on the ground with a kind of wooden pillow beside them. Those were the beds. A prisoner came to the window after the police had left and called to us, "Frenchman, Frenchman." "What do you want?"
"Frenchman? No good, no good."
"Who do you mean, no good?"
"Police."
"Yeah, police?"
"Yes, police are no good."
And he disappeared. Night fell. The room was lit by a bulb that must have been of a very low voltage, for it gave hardly any light. Mosquitoes buzzed round our ears, got into our noses. "Well, a fine mess we are in. It's going to cost us a packet, having landed those guys."
"That's how it is. We couldn't tell. The real thing was there was no wine."
"You went into too close," said Klaus Zeot. "Just to shut up your trap, will you? This is no time for blame. This is when we have to get to back on one another up. We have got to hold together now more than ever."
"Sorry, you are right, Papi. It was nobody's fault."
"Oh, it would be too unfair if the break were to come to an end here so wretchedly. After we had such a struggle, they had not searched us. I had my charger in my pocket and hurriedly stuffed it up. So did Klaus Jord. We had been wise not to throw them away. In any case, they were waterlight wallets, easy to carry, and they took us up very little room. According to my watch, it was 8 in the evening. They bought us some dark brown sugar, a lump the size of your fist for each man, and 3, what you might call gobs of boiled and salted rice.
"Buenas noches?"
"That must mean good night," said Maturate. At 7 the next day, they gave us a very little good coffee in the wooden bowls out there in the courtyard. At about 8, the captain came by. I asked him for permission to go to the boat to fetch our things. He either didn't understand or he pretended not to. The more I saw him, the more he seemed to me to have a murdering knife of a face, kind of a face. On the left-hand side of his belt, he had a little bottle in a leather case. He took it out, uncorked it, drank a mouthful, spat and offered it to me. This was the first friendly gesture we had seen, so I took it and drank. Fortunately, I had only poured very little into my mouth. It was liquid fire and it tasted like methylated spirits. Quickly, I swallowed and began to cough, which made this half-black, half-Indian laugh very cheerfully. At 10 o'clock, several civilians appeared, dressed in white and wearing ties. There were 6 or 7 of them, and they went into a building that seemed to be the prison's administrative center. We were sent for. They were all sitting there in a semicircle in a room dominated by the picture of a very much decorated white officer, President Alfonso Lopez of Colombia. One of these gentlemen met Clausier sit down, speaking to him in French. The rest of us remained standing. A thin hook-nosed party in the middle who wore half glasses began questioning me. The interrupter interrupted none of it, but said to me, "The man who has just spoken and who is going to interrogate you is the magistrate of the town of Rio Haca. The others are prominent citizens, friends of his. I am Haitan, and I took after the electricity in these parts. I act as interpreter. I believe some of the people here understand a little French, though they don't say so, maybe even the magistrate." This preamble made the magistrate impatient and he broke in with this interrogation in Spanish. The Haitan translated the question and answer as they came. "Are you French?"
"Yes."
"Where do you come from?"
"Curacao."
"And before that?"
"Trinidad."
"And before that?"
"Martinique."
"You are lying. More than a week ago, our consul in Curacao was warned that the coast should be watched
because 6 men who had escaped from the French Penna settlement were going to try to land in our country.
All right, we did escape from the Penna settlement.
You are a Carignan then?
Yes.
If so noble a country as France sent you as far as punished you so severely, it must be because you are very dangerous malefactors.
Maybe.
Theft or murder?
Manslaughter.
Killing. It's all one. So you are matadors. Then, where are the other three?
They stayed in Curaçao.
You are lying again. You landed them 35 miles from here in a region called Castellet. Fortunately, they have been arrested and they will be here in a few hours. Did you steal the boat?
No. The Bishop of Curaçao gave it as a present.
All right. You will stay in prison here until the governor has made up his mind what is to be done with you for the crime of landing three of you accomplices on Colombian territory and then trying to put us on the sea again. I sentence you, the captain of the vessel, to 3 months imprisonment and the other two to 1 month. You had better behave. If you don't want the police to inflict corporal punishment, they are very severe men. Have you anything to say?
No. I'd just like to collect my belongings and the stores abroad the boat.